All right. I am Heather Reisman. As I say every time we have one of these evenings, I am Indigo's chief book lover, and it is a total pleasure to welcome you all here tonight. Thank you for coming out.
For me, even though I had promised everybody who loved me that I would not write another book, what changed my mind was when I saw that my own personal journey was intersecting with where the culture was going. Because my wake-up call that I start the book with on April 6, 2007 was to collapse from burnout, exhaustion, and sleep deprivation, hit my head on my desk, break my cheekbone, get 4 stitches on my right eye. And as I came to, and then during the endless doctor's visits to find out if there was anything really medically wrong with me, I started asking all these questions that we stop asking in college, like what is a good life? What is success? And while by conventional definitions of success I was successful, by any sane definition of success, if you're lying in a pool of blood on the floor of your office and you have not been shot by somebody, you are not successful. So that's really what started me looking at what was happening around us and seeing that burnout is truly the disease of our civilization. Mm-hmm. And it's partly because of the way we've defined success. We define success simply in terms of 2 metrics, money and power, and this is like trying to sit on a 2-legged stool. Sooner or later you fall off. And the third leg is the third metric, which is really about our fulfillment, which is about our well-being, wisdom, wonder. You know, outside this beautiful bookstore, you have, you know, imagination, creativity, all these things are related to wonder, and they complete life. Mm-hmm. And finally, the fourth pillar of the third metric, giving. So that we don't just honor and celebrate go-getters, but we also celebrate go-givers.
I actually found it quite interesting that it's the third metric, but it has 4 yes. pillars. We'll get to how that math works out together for an economics master's in economics. But just go over those again for the group, yes. those 4.
So the 4 pillars, and each pillar is a section in the book. The first is well-being. Because, you know, you see, if we sacrifice our health and well-being in the pursuit of success, it really makes no sense. And that's why it's absolutely key to look at what are these essential elements of our well-being. And now, the great thing, the reason I love living at this time, is that modern science is validating ancient wisdom every day. Yeah. And I have 55 pages of scientific endnotes that show, for example, that something that we've kind of despised in our culture, sleep, is actually incredibly important. It's almost like a miracle drug. You know, if you look at the connection between health, high blood pressure, diabetes, heart disease, our autoimmune system, and sleep, not to mention our mental clarity, the connection to Alzheimer's, is just unbelievable. And yet our culture, and this is something actually that men have to take some responsibility for, but not the men in this room. You are completely exempt. But the other men who created this culture and started basically celebrating people who work 24/7. How often do you hear that in your offices? If anybody says that in my presence, I said, congratulating somebody for working 24/7 is like congratulating them for coming to work drunk. Wisdom. You know, we look around and we see many successful people who are very smart with great degrees making terrible decisions. Mm-hmm. It's not that they're not smart, they're not wise. And I quote Bill Clinton in the book, and I know you're interviewing him soon, who said that most important mistakes I made in my life are made when I was tired. Right. And definitely I can testify to that. When I look back at my life, you know, when I overreacted, when I took things personally, hired the wrong people, whatever, it was all when I was tired, burnt out.
Yeah.
And I was with Donna Shalala, who's the University of Miami president, last week, and she said, you cannot lead when you're not rested.
I bet that's true.
Yeah.
I bet that's true.
And she said, because also we always then suddenly have crises in our lives, the unexpected things that happen. So at least then we have reserves to draw on.
So we can't get to wisdom if we're tired.
Well, you know, it's hard to get to the inner wisdom.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because we forget that we have inner wisdom, because we're always so buried in our to-do lists and our smartphones that we forget that there is actually a very wise, strong part in us that when we connect to, we are more resilient, wiser, and
how
more
do we
effective.
How do we connect it? One is to get sleep.
Another
but how else do we connect?
To introduce it? Some silence and quiet time in our lives. And I recommend just starting with 5 minutes. You know, I want to make it very manageable for people. And that's why I have, at the end of each of these sections, each of these pillars, I have 3 little steps, 4 sections, 3 steps, 12 steps total, which is not accidental because we are addicted. So we need a 12-step program.
Right.
And one of the steps is start with 5 minutes of meditation. And you will get the reward. You don't have to start with more. I know you will move to more. Because the reward is so obvious when we begin to introduce some quiet time, some silence in our lives when we are not doing anything else. And Archimedes, my compatriot, the great scientist, he said, give me a place to stand and I can move the world. And that place is inside us.
Right.
And that's why what I want to make it very clear, you may be thinking, you know, I'm just starting in my life, I want to succeed. Perfect. This book is not against the first 2 metrics. It just is in favor of integrating the 3rd. And when we do, I can promise you one thing. You are going to be more successful and more effective without paying the price that our culture pays.
So we have well-being, wisdom,
wonder, which is basically tapping into the mystery of life. You know, that's what poetry and art and music are about. And we want them in our lives because they give us a glimpse into another reality, another world. Whether you consider yourself spiritual or a believer or not, it doesn't matter. It's what Reid Hoffman, I was speaking at LinkedIn last week, and he's the founder of LinkedIn. And he said to me, I consider myself a mystical atheist. He said, I don't believe in God. But I cannot avoid the reality that this is an incredible mystery we're living in the middle of.
Right, the wonder of the world.
The wonder of the world that we don't fully understand. And so that's the wonder section. And it's actually one of my favorite sections. So the 4th is giving. And, you know, the book is dedicated to my mother, who was kind of the ultimate giver. And what she taught me is that even when you don't have anything, because I grew up in a one-room apartment in Athens, who really had very little money. I don't say no money because you immediately think of people homeless and in shelters in Africa, but it was very tough. And my mother never made us feel that we were limited by our circumstances. She always made us feel that we're bigger than our circumstances and that we could also find something to give to others. It obviously wasn't money, but it could be something. I remember once she had a little necklace and a woman admired it, a stranger, and my mother gave it to her. And she turned to her and she said, what can I give you in return? And my mother said, it's not a trade, darling. It's an offering.
It's a gift.
It's a gift. You know, it's not a trade, because in our lives we think everything as being a trade.
Right.
And the other thing that she taught me about giving is that how do we connect with people that we normally take for granted? You know, you come here to buy a book. Do you really connect with the person selling it to you? The cleaning crew in your offices, the barista in the coffee shop. My mother could not have an impersonal connection. She would ask them about themselves. If the FedEx man came to deliver a package, she would bring them into the kitchen and say, hey, I just made something. Sit down and have something. And it was just... So she lived in this kind of amazing place of connections, of aliveness.
I think
the 3rd metric is not another thing. It's basically changing the way we experience life and moving from struggle to grace. That's how I see it. Mm-hmm. Now, let me just make it very clear. That doesn't mean bad thing won't happen. That doesn't mean there won't be obstacles and things that happen during the day that we wish didn't happen, or worse, crises. It does mean that we're going to approach all that completely differently.
Right.
And that, for me, is the key. Because what we realize when we begin to live that way is that life is shaped from the inside out. Mm-hmm. We think life is shaped from the outside in. But all the people I quote in the book, stoic philosophers, spiritual teachers, poets, will tell us it's not so. that in fact, even Viktor Frankl, you know, who lost his brother, his pregnant wife, his family in a concentration camp, he said the one freedom nobody can take away is the freedom to choose our own attitude. So we have a choice to live life as victims or to live life as adventurers looking for this treasure in whatever life brings us. And
say a little bit about, given that you've spent, you know, a couple of years putting this together, talking to people, what would be some of the things we would feel on our way to full burnout?
Well, first of all, it's so important to realize that very often, as Heather said, we are not aware that we are burnt out. You know, if you have an iPhone, I know you are in Canada, I have four Blackberries too, so don't worry. You get alerts, like 20% battery remaining, 17% battery remaining. By about 13%, we begin to get nervous. We look for a recharging shrine, and they're everywhere. But when I collapsed, I must have been below zero battery remaining, but I wasn't even aware of it.
You were still operating.
I was still operating, and I think there was one lady at Sheryl Sandberg and I did a conversation in San Francisco, and at the end of it, a woman said to us, you know, I don't remember, a young woman, I don't remember the last time I was not tired. And so we learn to live like that. And I think one of the most important things to develop is that clear sense of when you are tired, exhausted, approaching burnout. And I'm now, it's the one thing, you know, I'm a work in progress. I'm not sitting here telling you I'm doing it all perfectly by any means at all. But one thing that I have learned, one thing, there are things I'm doing really well and things I'm still trying to do well.
Right.
So one of the things I'm doing well is I know when I'm feeling really burnt out. Like, you can check with your house staff that I had a very early start, and I worked, did, I don't know, 20 media interviews and everything. And then I had conference calls, because we have a big Thrive conference in New York Thursday, Friday. And then this, and I said, I really want to be 100% present for this. I was really looking forward to our conversation. I canceled my conference calls, and I did an hour meditation. And you know what? We have to make these choices.
Yeah. And you know, the reality is, the Thrive Conference is probably going to be just fine.
Yes.
And you're actually going to enjoy the present.
Most important is that I'm now 1,000% present.
Yeah.
And joyful. You know, I get goosebumps as I'm saying. I think for me, joy is a great barometer of how burnt out we are or we are not.
So sleep and meditation are two things you believe in. And
yes,
you do talk about a lot. And that those are two things. We're all short of sleep, and most of us are not spending time meditating. So you could almost say, if you aren't doing those things, you're headed to burnout.
And also, when I say, well, sleep, when I say meditation, I want each person listening to substitute their own word. Your word could be prayer. It could be contemplation.
Right.
It could be quiet time if you're a Quaker. You know, don't be attached to the word.
Right.
Because it's basically about introducing some silence and quiet time in our lives to reconnect with ourselves. Whatever does it for you. Some people say, fly fishing does it for me. I say, great, as long as you can get to that place without having to go fly fishing.
There's a wonderful opening,
about
the rain. Maybe you could just read this beginning in the poem. And then I wanted to talk to you a little bit about this, because it was the idea of wonder, I think, is the thing we most leave behind when we're children. Like, all children paint. All children, it's the very first thing that everybody knows who has children. It's the very first thing little ones do. Stickers, and then they paint. And then nobody paints after a certain age. Like, nobody. And I think it's the same about wonder.
Yes.
So could you just read that little bit, and we'll talk a little bit about wonder.
So on the morning after the launch of HuffPost Germany in October 2013, I was in a car on my way to the airport from the center of Munich. It was raining, which gave everything a beautiful, almost magical shimmer. All the buildings and trees seemed wrapped in wonder. Yet when I arrived at the airport, everyone I talked to was complaining about the rain. We are all experiencing the same weather, but with very different results. Wonder is not just the product of what we see, of how beautiful or mysterious or singular or incomprehensible something may be. is just as much a product of our state of mind, our being, the perspective from which we are looking at the world. At a different time, in a different city, maybe even most times in most cities, I too might have been annoyed by the rain. But at this particular time, in this particular city, what came to my mind instead was a poem by Albert Hofstetter. I know his name sounds German, but he's from Texas. We forget we are mostly water till the rain falls and every atom in our body starts to go home.
So beautiful, right? So what do you do now that you're even more conscious of this to enhance the amount of wonder that you feel in life?
So I feel that when I take the small little steps that we mentioned, and let me mention a couple of others that are specific to wonder. One of them is every day, this is the first step at the end of the wonder chapter, every day at the end of your day or during the day, pick something that you no longer need and remove it from your life. It could be a resentment, a grudge. Mm-hmm. It could be a project that you think you're going to do, but really you're not going to. Because sometimes we're so cluttered that we cannot be really present and experience wonder. I mean, I do regular life audits. For example, I recently gave up the idea that I was ever going to be a good skier. And, you know, it's been very liberating. I actually realized that you can complete a project by dropping it. So I feel skiing is done for me.
I'm thinking about...
But also I think that's very... In your commencement speech that I loved, you talk about surround yourself with positive people. That's another way to experience wonder. I had this dream that I write about in the Wonder chapter once when I saw my life. I mean, it was a metaphor for how I saw my life, that I was on a train going home to God. So I'm comfortable talking about God and I believe in God. But if God doesn't do it for you, you can use some other word, like I'm going home. And in my train was my family and my friends. And everything that happened in my life was scenery. You know, some of it was beautiful scenery, some of it was ugly scenery, but the train kept moving on. And that's the nature of life. And pain happens when we cling either to the special things or to the painful things.
The purpose of the book is to make us think and grow and advance our own ability to be present in life. And there is no greater gift.
Thank you. Well, my
there is
hope,
no greater gift.
My hope is that the book will be a bridge between people knowing what we should be doing and actually doing it. And that's why I added the steps. That's why I added the appendices that have like 12 apps that you can use to learn to meditate or 12 apps that you can use to avoid distractions. I know it's a paradox. In fact, I have a section called the I Paradox. That we are using technology to help us disconnect from technology. But actually, there are some great apps and features that can help us. And because we're addicted, right. We have to realize that sometimes it's hard for us to really focus on what we want to do. And let me just say one thing that's very important. I have two very different daughters. My youngest daughter has no social media presence. She's a painter. And she can spend hours completely undistracted. And my oldest daughter, Christina Huffington, has a fantastic Instagram presence and is a social media maven. And I watch how important it is for both daughters, like for all of us, whatever our disposition, to learn to have time alone, to learn to have time when we can think, and to start our day not by immediately going to our smartphone. Because if you think of it, people who create things are not always at the mercy of what is incoming. You know, I quote Steve Jobs in the book, who said, some of my best ideas that led to the most iconic Apple products came after Zen meditation. Bill Gates famously would have think weeks when he would go away without technology. So in our own lives, whatever it is we're doing, it's important to allow that little time for us. And you said earlier something which was very important about how creative children are, right. And then we forget about it. To keep our creativity going, even if we can't make a living that way. If we like to sing, sing. Right. Even if nobody's paying you. You know, there are people now who are joining what are known as threshold choirs, and they go to hospices, and they sing for people who are dying, because the hearing is the last sense that goes. And I was talking to some of them, and it's so wonderful. The volunteers love to sing, and now they found a vehicle of expression for some that they love to do, but they thought, hey, you know, I can't be an opera singer, so I'm going to abandon that.
But you don't have to be an opera singer to enjoy that
exactly.
part. This book is a gift. It is a treasure to have it, and it's so wonderful to have you
Thank
here, Arianna.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
We're going to allow everybody to get their book signed and to have their little moment with Arianna. Thrive.
And fantastic. Let me just say, we're having a campaign, hashtag How I Thrive. If we'd love to have your ways you thrive. It could be one line, it could be a picture, just anything, because it's like sharing recipes with each other. We can all learn from each other. So hashtag How I Thrive. Thank you so much.
I could have gone on doing this for